Darryl, this is exciting to have you here for many, many reasons. You know, you really have in my life as I've researched. I mean, from Miles to the Stones. I mean, that's an incredible wide gamut of musical influence, of this constant career that you just keep on going and reinventing yourself and just going stronger than ever. Where did it begin for you? Where did this start? Your dad was a drummer?
Yeah, my dad was a drummer, never professionally, but there was always a practice pad. You would always come in the house and you hear him in the basement with this practice pad.
Interesting.
And he'd, you know, practice, you know, four-way independent stuff on bar stools and whatever was, you know, under stick, basically. And so I grew up with that in the house. And I think when I was about 7, I asked him, I'd like to get involved with that.
Yeah.
And so he went under the bar that he'd built and pulled out this little xylophone. Because I guess he wanted me, you know, even though I was interested in playing drums, he wanted me to understand, you know, music.
Melodic and,
you know,
theory.
Yeah, exactly.
Very smart.
So he just basically started me on a C major scale and a chromatic scale on the xylophone. And then he bought me a little practice pad. And some sticks, you know, and I started messing around with it. I can't say that I was completely serious about it, but a couple of years later, I saw a neighbor in a school talent show, elementary school talent show, and I didn't even know that he played. And all the guys, basically, the curtains open, and there's all these guys that I knew. They had been my play leaders. They were a little bit older than me,
yeah.
You know, but. I saw these guys play, and it hit me like a shot. It really did. I mean, at that moment, I decided I'm going to be a musician. And I was as sure of that as I've been of anything in my life. That there was something about that moment, the way the audience responded, the fact that I knew them, and that it was, you know, this exciting thing to me that I was already, you know, a little bit, you know, in the game. So that's basically how it started.
So it's almost like it's a calling. You felt something that just said,
yeah,
this is where I'm going.
Yeah, yeah.
Boy, this is important because as we have these videos for the next generation to listen to and watch and understand, it's that instinctive feeling that you felt that this is what I'm doing and I'm going for it.
Yeah.
That's powerful. Yeah. That's very, very powerful. So how did it go from you know, did you take lessons?
Yeah.
Did you?
I decided when I see Angus again, this guy, Angus Thomas, who played with Miles after I left the band for a little while.
Interesting.
I decided when I see him, I'm going to ask him to teach me how to play. And he said, do you want to learn how to play lead guitar or bass guitar? And I said, what do you play? And he said, I play bass. And so that's how I got to be a bass player. He suggested that I also go and start taking lessons, you know, reading and all of that stuff. He was teaching me mostly songs.
Interesting.
Which was also really a great thing because
there
were great songs like I'll Take You There, Staple Singers, Ramblin' On by Led Zeppelin, Purple Haze, you know, all of these, a real pretty, pretty wide range of different kinds of tunes.
Interesting.
Thank You for Letting Me Be Myself was the first song he taught me, though it wasn't the Larry Graham version. I wasn't playing what Larry Graham was playing, let's put it that way. But so I got started in that. He later went to a high school with a really great music program, Chicago Vocational High School. I followed him there and got involved in that music program. And it wasn't really until college that I realized that that program was so advanced and we were dealing with music, playing all these talent shows, the teacher's talent show, the band talent show, the orchestra talent show, the student's talent show, you know, there were all of these. So there was always all this music to learn. We were playing classical music with the orchestra that I was in, jazz stuff, Ellington tunes. There was all of this different stuff. And it was when I got to college that I realized, wow, a lot of you guys have been drawing screws for the last 4 years. I've been playing pretty much professionally for the last 4 years. And so that's when I really realized that maybe I had a little bit of an advantage in having gone through that program. It was a really great program, a guy named Dr. Joseph Miller.
Interesting, and this is Chicago. Chicago really has you know, a musical bubble that is created that is extremely powerful.
It really does, and the unfortunate thing is there's no, the ceiling is kind of low, you know, particularly after the guys with Chess and all of those, you know, record companies left Chicago. There's a real low ceiling, but you still have all of these musicians in Chicago who play in every little nook and cranny around there. And so who are really great musicians, but they don't get to be famous in the way that they would if you were maybe in New York or in Los Angeles.
Right. So you start working, you're playing more professionally, you're starting to organize your schedule, you know, you're starting to keep yourself, you know, into that professional level. Mm-hmm. Where did it go from there? So you kind of...
Well, I was playing around Chicago with a lot of different bands, and a guy named Phil Upchurch, who actually is...
Great musician.
You know, he's an incredible musician. He's also on all of that Chess stuff, on a bunch of that Chess stuff.
Absolutely.
Playing bass and guitar. He would come, but he was living in LA, but he would come back to Chicago and play a gig and, you know, like a little residence in a club or two in town. And that was a gig that I was aware of, that I was like, I would really love to play that gig because the music was a little bit more challenging than what we were, you know, playing around town. And so I eventually got called for that gig. And that's really what put me on the map in Chicago, where guys started looking at me a little bit differently.
Yeah.
From there, Miles Davis's nephew, Vince Wilburn Jr., and I were also playing on this scene in Chicago.
What did he play?
He plays drums.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. He called me one day. He'd just gotten back from Japan with Miles. He called and said, "Hey, man, Miles wants to hear you play over the phone." And I'm like, wait a minute, quit joking. I mean, it's that serious, you know. We've dreamt about that, sitting in front of the house, you bringing me home from gigs when I was too young to drive a car, you know. And he said, no, and I end up talking to Miles on the phone that day. And the next day, I end up auditioning for Miles the gig.
This is so heavy. First of all, I mean, Miles, and even a name like Phil Upchurch.
Yeah.
And I always loved his name.
Yeah.
Up, correct. Always lifting, yeah, going right, up. Yeah. And sure, yeah, I mean, this guy really had it all together, yeah, even his name. Yeah. The thing is about this generation that watches these videos, when they see an even name like Phil Upchurch, to go research that.
Right. Yeah.
These names that you're being said, these are powerful.
Absolutely.
Miles, of course, you're talking to Miles on the phone. It doesn't get any deeper than that. What was that like when you're on the phone with him and you're talking to him? And
I basically, what had happened is I'd said to Vince, okay, let me get my bass, you know, and so I go looking around the house, and I'm really embarrassed to say that my bass was in the trunk of my mother's car. I had decided at that point, I'm not doing any more gigs for $50 or whatever it is. And so I was practicing this Chapman stick thing, and I was like, I'm not even playing bass until they pay me more money in town, you know. So my mother had just yelled downstairs and said, do you have any gigs this week, you know? And I was like, no, Mom, I told you I'm not taking any more $50 gigs. She said, you better take some of those $50 gigs. You can't just stay in this house. You know, I'm like 21 years old. And she, I guess she was just frustrated. So she finally said, just come and wash the dishes. And that's when the phone rang.
Oh my gosh.
I was washing dishes when the phone rang. So Miles eventually, you know, Vince, I go back to the phone and I say, Vince, hold on. And he says, no, you hold on. And so the next sound I hear is, Dad, when can you be in New York? And I'm thinking, well, it's Miles Davis, so I gotta be cool.
Yeah.
So I said, oh, I could be there. It was a Monday. I could be there by Wednesday. He said, what's gonna take you so long? You're gonna walk. So I said, oh, no, I'll be there tomorrow morning. I'm sure I can be there tomorrow morning. So I flew out the next morning and auditioned for him, basically. He had me play along.
Where was your audition?
In New York.
Right near it.
In Cicely Tyson's niece's apartment.
Oh my gosh, that's
you
incredible.
Know?
That's incredible. You know? So you're 21.
I'm 21 years old. I go in. He says, play along with this gig, you know, board tape from a gig. Yeah. You don't have to play what the guy's playing. Just play, you know, what you would play in that situation. It's like kind of funky jams with lines and stuff like that they were playing. I played that for a little while. He says, okay, can you play a B-flat blues? Real slow. And I said, oh yeah, sure. So I started. And he grabbed the bass, he said, I mean slow. And so I started playing again, and he stopped me. He said, no, I mean real slow. So I'm playing this B-flat blues for about two, three, four minutes. And he's just listening, you know. And him and Vince get up and go in the back room, and Vince comes out and says, you got it. And I'm like, no. I need him to tell me.
Interesting.
And so he comes out and hits me in the shoulder and says, you got it.
How powerful is that? So this kind of, a great story, Darryl. What's interesting is that this is about the ultimate degree of networking, mm-hmm. of where you came from, where you started, who you talked to, who you met. You know, networking is an extremely important tool for this younger generation to understand what that's mean, to have the personality to converse and meet and talk and be friendly and acceptable and polite and all that stuff that comes with it. Miles had this incredible talent of being able to find young, great future musicians on all instruments. And the fact that they had 21, when was the first gig?
The first gig was 8 days later.
I rehearsed. So did you stay in New York?
I stayed in New York, rehearsed with the band like once.
Yeah.
Or with part of the band. I think Mino, Sina Lou, Al Foster was playing drums at the time. Rehearsed with them, and I think John Scofield came to rehearsal. Mike Stern was in the band at the time. Rehearsed once with them, flew back to Chicago and just started getting it together, and flew to St. Louis for the 7th of June. All that happened on the last day of May 1983. I auditioned the 1st of June, and we played the first gig the 7th of June.
Well, that's incredibly powerful. What a life lesson. You know, you mentioned names like Al Foster and Scofield and Mike Stern. These are names that, again, I want people to understand. Mm-hmm. Do the research.
Yes.
These are names that you're just kind of throwing out because you work with the guys. Mm-hmm. These are powerful. Oh, it's not even like all of them have had careers. They've got movements.
Exactly.
Al Foster has my heart when he plays.
Oh, man.
He just swings, you know, when he just sits at the drum set before he even grabs the sticks, he's swinging.
It's really it.
Yeah. So how long are you with Miles? What happened as you went on the road?
Played with Miles for over a year. Went on the road, did, you know, the festivals in the States, and more importantly, we did a lot more work in Europe at that time. We did a whole tour of just France.
Wow.
But all over Europe, back and forth in the States. Branford Marsalis came in and played on the first record that I played on, which was with Miles. That was like probably November 83, that we started recording that record. So I met Branford, whom I had met the first night I played with Miles, because he was playing with Herbie Hancock at the time. And it was odd. What's odd about that, I have to mention, is that in the music magazines, he and Wynton were considered the anti-electric guys, particularly Wynton.
Right.
And so I didn't think that I was going to have any real friends there that first night. I realized those guys are, you know, probably not. Well, they were very, very welcoming to me, both him and Wynton, which was a big thing because these guys were at the pinnacle. They were my age.
Yeah.
And they really welcomed me. You know, I have to say that Wynton really welcomed me.
That says a lot about your playing, because they were kind of anti-electric in what they were.
Yeah.
So the fact you must have played so great that you just, they surpassed the electronic part of it and got to the core of the music. That's really huge.
That's what they were talking about. But I was just doing the best that I could. That was another part of it. It's like I decided before I went on stage that first night, you know, I have to really play the way I play tonight.
Yeah.
And I have to just do it absolutely the best that I can.
Yeah.
And if that works, then this will be a great ride.
Right.
You know, if not, I don't want to get caught up trying to play like the guy before me, or because then I'll have to keep doing that.
Right.
So and also because it's Miles Davis, and you know, of course we'd all heard about his mercurial personality and I just decided every night I go on stage, I'm just going to play the best that I can play, which is not the same as the most that I can play. You know what I mean? It's like I'm going to listen and pay attention and really try to be in the music, you know, and let the musicians around me influence what I play, you know, and Miles. And so that became a kind of every night thing. Much later on, I was with Miles one night. He would always ask me to bring my bass when I just hung out with him in the apartment. And he said, play that thing that you play on the little part where I give you a solo. So I picked up the bass and I started playing. And he doubles over and he grabs the bass and he says, damn, did you hear the way you played that first note? And I was like, what? But what had happened is that effort to play the best that I could play at every moment that I was on stage with him had really kind of gotten into my natural way of playing.
That's huge.
You know what I mean? And so when I was playing this note, I was just going boop, you know, but it was coming out like, you know, because there was all of this intention behind it, you know.
But it's funny you mentioned that word, because when I interviewed Steve Gadd, we talked about being in the moment, in the now, and intention about the before you even play, where is your mind at?
Yeah.
You know, the intention of being able to play the best you can play, which I love your humility. Mm-hmm. That's powerful. Mm-hmm. To play the best you can play in the moment at that time, to react to what's happening at that time, and to be able to listen to every musician all the time.
Right.
So you hear everything going on. That's a skill that yeah. takes time to learn. That obviously Miles saw that in you, as did yeah. Winton and Branford,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah.
Incredible. So just talking about the business part. So now you're playing with these guys. Are you keeping track of, like, you know, finances? Are you finding yourself organizing yourself? Are you writing it? Do you have a schedule book? Is there anything?
Not so much.
Yeah.
Not so much at that period. I mean, I wasn't doing really silly things with the money. I was definitely buying instruments and trying to, you know, find the best amplifier and trying to find, you know, gear that would really work. But I looking back, I really wish I had been much more, you know, conscious of those things. I do remember, you know, 6 or 8 months in, hiring an accountant.
Nice.
And my parents were very, very adamant that I paid taxes on time,
nice.
And what I was supposed to pay, because they said the list of musicians who go out and do well and then lose it all because
absolutely.
They haven't taken care of those things
absolutely.
Is long, you know,
absolutely.
You know, and so so that was something that they were, you know, kind of on me about. So I guess in that way, I did, you know, take, you know, pay attention to those kinds of, you know, dotting of I's and crossing.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to pay attention to that.
Tell me a little bit about your parents, because you're 21, you're washing dishes, next thing you know, you get a call, then you're leaving the next day to go talk to Miles and play with him. And then you're on tour with Miles, and you didn't really go back right away. So what was their reaction to all this?
Well, my dad, you know, was jazz musician. He, you know, of course, you know, when I walked upstairs after that phone call and said to him, "Can you lend me a couple hundred bucks? I got to get to New York. I got an audition with Miles Davis." He kind of looked at me like, "Okay, but you got an audition with Miles Davis." You know what I mean? He was, you know. But no, then when things started working out well, they basically, you know, I have to say, you know, people say to me, you know, your parents must have been very proud of you.
Yeah.
The truth is, man, I'm very proud of my parents.
Wow.
I was lucky with that one. Very open, inquisitive people who taught me to be proud of who I am, taught me to make sure that people treated me, you know, with respect, no matter who they were, and also gave me the tools to kind of go out in the world and do, like what you were talking about, be polite to people, be fair with people. You know, don't be too messy. Don't be trying to get into too many, things. Just trying to, you know, kind of keep your place, have fun.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
You know, that's one of the things I tell musicians a lot is, like, you don't need to be in every conversation. You don't need, you know, there's a certain, because, like, we know a lot of great musicians who can play their ass off. But they can't keep a gig because there's something that they're doing wrong socially.
Absolutely.
You know? I was given all of those tools
powerful.
Before I got to be 21 years old and all of this stuff happened. So, I thank them for that.
That is beautiful. That's powerful, because that's an important message for this next generation to realize that those still core principles and values and ethics of who we are as people really is going to be probably the strongest connection when you meet people that's going to, where they're going to believe in you and then going to want to be involved with you.
Exactly.
So how did the Stones, here you go.
That was much later.
Yeah.
Actually, this weird thing happened where I was playing with Miles Davis and through Branford got introduced to Sting and auditioned for his gig.
Right.
And basically there came a time where, you know, Miles said to me, "What are you going to do when you got a gig with me and a gig with Sting on the same day?" And I was really, you know, I was suffering, man, trying to figure out how I was going to leave Miles Davis. And I eventually did do that, and played with Sting for that year, which really changed things in terms of you know, the there's a certain scene that knew me
right.
from playing with Miles. Right. It's a different scene.
You widened that scene.
I did,
pretty
and that's what I was hoping to do. Yeah, that's really what I was hoping to do, you know. And I was actually even more blessed that after I did the thing with Sting, I called Miles just to tell him I missed him, and he asked me to come back to the band.
You know, wonderful.
So that was, you know, just a, you know, a blessing on top of a blessing.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And so I just kind of from there, you know, the Miles Davis thing. I have to say, my case is really unique because it's an incredible calling card.
Yeah.
You know, there's a handful of gigs that are like that where you play with someone. And because they have so much respect, and their track record for hiring great musicians is so you know, so known, that you know, you go into an audition and people say, "Well, who have you played with?" And you say, "Well, I played with Miles Davis," and they're kind of like, "Okay, I guess we'll."
It changes. It's a game changer.
Yeah, it changes everything.
Big game changer.
So I went from Miles to Sting, back to Miles to Herbie Hancock,
right.
to Peter Gabriel, played with Herbie again, started doing a few records here and there. I did a record with John Scofield, later did a record with Eric Clapton, and I was introduced to Keith Richards through Charlie Drayton and Steve Jordan. We were running buddies in New York. At that time I'd moved to New York, and we used to hang with them a lot, and they introduced me to Keith, and a number of years later, I heard a rumor that Bill Wyman was leaving the band. Mm. And of course, you know, there had been rumors of him leaving for many, many years, you know, and so I didn't really take it serious. And a friend of mine said, "No, from what I'm hearing, he's really leaving."
Yeah.
And I was just on the phone with this guy, a guy named Sandy Toronto, great guitarist out of Florida. He says, I'm just kind of like there, and he says, "Man, should I get Mick's management's number?" And I said, "Yeah, I guess you should." You know. And he called me back 10 minutes later. I called and spoke to someone, and I said, "I heard that, you know, the Stones might be looking for a bass player. If there's a list, I'd certainly like to be on it." And, and she said, "Well, nothing's going to happen for a while, but when it happens, you know, I'll be sure that they know that you call." You know. So I had met Mick also when we did the Dream of the Blue Turtles film with Sting.
Sting, yeah.
Met him one night backstage, and they called me to audition.
Where was the audition?
The audition was in New York at the old SIR on 52nd Street.
Yeah. A great room.
I went in and played through a bunch of, you know, their hits, you know the big Stones tunes, and then a few months later, they had gone to the islands and started writing the Voodoo Lounge material. It was at that point that one night Keith came to me and said, "Listen, man, we'd like you to do the record with us."
Nice.
So I went in and did Voodoo Lounge. That was in November of 93.
Wow.
A few months later, they were back in LA mixing and doing additional recording, and I went to hang out just to hang out with them. And Keith said, "Did you see Charlie when he was here?" I said, no. He says, "Well, you just missed him." And he asked me, he says, "So we're going to take Darryl on the road, right?" And Keith said, "Well, yeah, Charlie, we auditioned all those guys, of course. And we picked Darryl, he's on the record, we're going to take him on the road." And Charlie said, "Don't you think we should tell him?" So he says, "So, I'm telling you, Charlie, we want you to go on the road." He was great.
Who else was in the band?
At that time, all of the guys, you know, Keith and Mick and Charlie and Ronnie, Lisa Fisher and Bernard Fowler. Mm. And as I came on, they also took on a horn section, which was Andy Snitzer, Kent Smith, and Mike Davis, who's just a killer trombone player. All of them are great players, man. They came on at the same time that I did. So that ended up being the band for quite a while. Later on, Blondie Chaplin came on. Mm. And stayed on for a while. And now, well, the band's a little bit different now, but a little bit smaller now.
So at this point, the band is playing, you're in the band. I mean, so now did any of your business skills change at that point now?
Well, you know, I met a guy named DJ McLaughlin when we were negotiating the Sting thing. And he and a guy named Ed Arundel, who I think both are still in the business.
Yeah.
They negotiated all four of us, me and Omar Bramford, and Kenny Cogan, they didn't go shoot our deal together. And just from, you know, just looking at how they did things, I was helped just, you know, to kind of know. And Omar Hakim said something to me one day that I've never really forgotten. And I have to say that it was great advice, especially considering like the Miles thing gave me a little bit more clout maybe than, you know, just a guy who'd, you know, been playing locally. Omar said, "Darryl, the kind of musician you are, when you take a gig, it's going to change the dynamic of the gig. Make them pay you.
Interesting.
If they don't want to pay you, go home and work on your own music." And I thought, that's good advice.
Yeah.
Even if I didn't take the go home and work on your own.
Absolutely.
You know, but
Omar's a bright player, cat, man. Philosopher.
Exactly.
He's very special guy.
Yeah. And so I've kind of just taken that, you know, just as, well, listen, if they won't pay me what I want to get paid, and I can, you know, say, well, no, I'm not going to do that in light of, you know, working on something for myself, then that has always been a little bit of a buffer between me having to just, between me just taking everything
Absolutely.
That I get offered, you know. And so, you know, it made me a little bit better negotiator, you know, that. And playing with Miles Davis, man, you know.
That's a great combination. You know, and what Omar talked about really was about leverage.
Yeah.
How to leverage in a discussion exactly. what you have to be able to pull out and make it fair and make it balance and worth your time and worth all your effort. This is powerful. I mean, these are all great lessons for you know, this next generation to understand of what you went through. This is real life experience of what you experienced. In closing, if we had to leave like a message to the next generation to understand where you are now and where you continue to go, you know how you're reinventing all of yourself in the process. What would you say to them to give them some kind of a you know, idea or tools or a path that they can, you know, pull from this to know what you went through, they can go through?
Yeah, I think first of all, you have to prepare yourself. There's a little bit of learning on the job, but in order to get the job, you have to be prepared. You know, the night before the first night I went on stage with Miles, he had sent someone, you know, he sent for me, and to come into his dressing room, and he says, "So, you have any questions?" And I said, "No." Well, I had been at home those days in between the audition and the gig, listening carefully to that music and really figuring out, well, what kind of thing are you going to play right here, and go back over that weird blues, you know, thing again, and make sure you know that stuff, and make sure that you know it in a way you're not like, oh, what was it, you know, that you really know it, you know, be, you know, so that you can really participate in the music, you know.
Yeah.
So he laughed, you know, when I said that, but I had already like said to myself, okay, put the tape on, you're on stage. Yeah. Can you actually do this honestly, you know?
Yeah.
And I, after a while, I played for about 5 minutes and I put the bass down and I thought, I feel like I can do this. Mm. I really feel like I can do this. So preparation, listening, you know, it's like we were just talking about.
Absolutely.
It's an art that not every musician learns Absolutely. In the same way, you know.
Absolutely.
And again, my almost like hypervigilance in terms of listening got really developed playing with Miles. If you look at film of me playing with Miles, everywhere he goes on stage those first year, everywhere he goes, I'm looking.
Yeah.
Because I'm not just trying to listen to what he's playing, I'm trying to feel what his intention is.
Huge.
You know? And so that's a skill. And letting what you play be informed by what is being played around you.
Beautiful.
If you're on stage and you're thinking, oh man, I practiced that lick last night and I really want to get it in,
you're out of the moment.
You're not paying attention to what's going on, you know.
Right.
And if you, the time that you spend hooking that lick up, it'll pay off down the line if you wait for the right time to play it. If you try to force it, it doesn't work, you know. Like you say, you're out of the moment.
Right.
So those two things, you know, having some social, you know, being able to get along with
some
people.
Kind of skill, yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's really important. One of the things that Charlie has said in a lot of interviews when they ask him about me, he's like, you know, this is, you know, it's like, you know, a few minutes on stage and the rest of the time you're basically living with this person.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you want to be on the road with someone that you don't want to, that you don't like being around?
Absolutely.
You know, so it's, you know, learning how to temper that and without you know, compromising yourself as a person.
Absolutely.
But you want to be able to know, you know, when to, you know, when to be quiet a little bit sometimes. And you don't have to, you know, I tell young guys sometimes, you don't have to say every thought that comes into your head. You know what I mean? You can let some stuff just, you know. So that's an important thing. And I just think realizing that one of the things that gets you there, one of the, you know, major things I think that gets you there is not thinking to yourself, I'm going to be great when I start playing with great musicians.
Right.
You have to, somebody told me something, speaking of Will, we were speaking about Will Lee.
Yeah.
When I got to New York, Charlie told me, he says, you know, I've heard Will play with drummers who were dragging, and it's almost like he can make them sound like they're not dragging. And I thought, that's something to shoot for.
Yeah, yeah.
The ability to be able to kind of morph,
yeah.
You know, and again, that takes really listening.
Yeah.
And really, you know, and because yeah, you can't fight them because
you
if you're fighting, you're not playing music.
And you got to know your instrument.
Right,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, those are some of the things. And the other thing is just, you know, playing from your heart, man. You know, if you play from your heart and you listen to the musicians around you, they all want to play with you again.
Yeah.
You know, and it takes that to be able to, because again, you know, how do you get hired? Musicians, we don't really have agents that much.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a little bit of that now, but...
Yeah, yeah.
How did Miles find all of these guys?
Yeah.
Other musicians
absolutely.
Told him.
Absolutely.
You know, Donald Byrd told him, you know,
that
told him about
networking of all guys. Yeah.
About
yeah,
Herbie
yeah.
Hancock.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, that, you know, I think Herbie told him about Tony Williams. You know, so it's like, you know, so that's how we get our work. So it does pay to, and that's why being at this the NAMM show is such a cool thing because you get to network.
Yeah.
You get to see musicians you haven't worked with and like guys like, man, I've always wanted to. You know, if something comes up, you know, let's, you know.
Boy, you're still discovering, you're still reaching out, you're still learning. This is incredible. Darryl Jones, you are one special person
oh,
at many
man.
Different levels, man. I thank you so much on behalf of the sessions.
Oh,
you offer so much to the next generation. This is exciting, and you really are an incredible example of where music is and where it should be going.
Thank you very
much.
I
thank
much,
you
man.
So much. Thank you, Darryl.
My pleasure.